Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Patty Otasek, and I'm from the College of Graduate Studies, and I see some very familiar faces of students who've been involved in our programs this past semester and past academic year, so thank you. We're glad to see that you're back again. This series is a series of three sessions on career and leadership development, and what this is kind of the capstone of our first year of operation as the Graduate Student Resource Center. The three sessions are going on during the month of April. We had one last week. This is our second one. Our third one will be in next Monday, April 27th. So if you're not registered for that, please go online and look into that one as well. That one's going to be about preparing your CV for your academic positions. The format today is very simple. Just a quick show of hands. How many of you were at the last session last week, if any? Okay, so it'll be a little familiar in format to some of you. For the others, just that you know, we'll run through a brief introduction of all of our panelists that are here and generously spending their time with us today. And then they'll go into their mini presentations about their experiences and about their history. And then we'll save some time at the very end for your questions and answers. So we'll get started with that. Meanwhile, any questions? Any concerns? Everyone comfortable? We'll probably go right up until about 5:30. Okay, then I will begin. Starting to my left here today, I'm very happy to welcome Dr. Ilya Yaroslavsky. Dr. Yaroslavsky received his bachelor's degree in psychology from the University of Pittsburgh at Johnstown and his PhD in clinical psychology from the University of Houston. Prior to joining CSU's psychology department in 2014, Dr. Yaroslavsky completed a National Research Service Award postdoctoral fellowship. He did that at the University of Pittsburgh School of Medicine. While there, he developed a research focused on the role of the autonomic nervous system in emotion regulation outcomes and in depression risk. Specifically, Dr. Yaroslavsky is interested in understanding how people's efforts to change the way they feel are influenced by their physiological states, their interpersonal environments, and how it contributes to their risk for depression. Welcome to the panel today, Dr. Yaroslavsky.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Glad to be here.
And next we have Dr. Julia Phillips. Dr. Phillips is an associate professor here at CSU. She's the co-director of the Counseling Psychology Doctoral Program in the College of Education and Human Services. Dr. Phillips received her PhD in Counseling Psychology from The Ohio State University in 1992 after she had completed her internship at Michigan State in the Counseling Center. Dr. Phillips is a licensed psychologist in the state of Ohio. She practiced at the University of Akron's Counseling Center for over 19 years and provided leadership for their APA-accredited internship program prior to joining CSU in 2014. Dr. Phillips has research and scholarly interests in professional issues, training of psychologists, and diversity issues. She's also a fellow of the American Psychological Association and active in leadership activities for Division 17, which is the Society for Counseling Psychology. Welcome to our panel, Dr. Phillips. And next we have Dr. Michael Nichols. Dr. Michael Nichols is here today from John Carroll University, where he serves as an associate professor in the Department of Chemistry. He received his Bachelor's of Science in Chemistry at Clarion University in Pennsylvania and a PhD in Physical Organic Chemistry from Duke University. He served as a postdoctoral researcher at Brown University and as a visiting professor at Kansas State and at Ohio universities prior to joining John Carroll in the fall of 1994. Dr. Nichols' research interests include the structure and reactivity of organoalkali chemistry, environmental water chemistry, and extensive organic and biochemistry laboratory experiments. He's been published in numerous scientific journals and served as a PI on several major National Science Foundation grants. Dr. Nichols has collaborated with several watershed groups and governmental agencies to study local streams, lakes, and wetlands. He's also served as the director of the Natural World Exploration portion of the John Carroll University core curriculum. Dr. Nichols is a member of John Carroll's Faculty Council and chair of the Committee on Academic Policies. Welcome to the panel, Dr. Nichols. And at the very end, ready to go out into the veranda there, hopefully you can all see Dr. Chandra Kodapalli. Dr. Kodapalli is an associate professor in the Department of Chemical and Biomedical Engineering here at Cleveland State University. He also holds adjunct appointments in biomedical engineering at the Cleveland Clinic and at Case Western Reserve School of Medicine. He received his PhD in bioengineering from Clemson University in a joint program with the Medical University of South Carolina. He performed postdoctoral work in the Biological Engineering Department at MIT and in the Biomedical Engineering Department at City University of New York. His research interests are in vascular tissue engineering, matrix biology, microfluidics, simulations and modeling, stem cells, and cancer cell biology. Dr. Cotopalli's research has resulted in one approved and two filed patents. His research is supported by the U.S. National Science Foundation and by institutional funds. Among his honors, Dr. Cotopalli is also awarded the Faculty Merit Award from Cleveland State University, both in 2013 and 2014. Welcome to our panel, Dr. Cotopalli. Next, we will begin with the presentations that each of our panelists will be sharing with you. This is your opportunity to learn from their experiences. And then, as I said, if you have questions following that, we'll be happy to take any questions toward the end. So I'll begin now to my left, and we'll move from there. We'll begin with Dr. Ilya Yaroslavsky.
Great. Thank you, Patty.
Sure.
I appreciate it. So in addition to thanking Patty for this lovely introduction, I want to thank the College of Graduate Studies for organizing this panel, and perhaps more importantly, for you folks for showing up to hear myself and my fellow presenters speak. So before I tell you a little bit about my experience on the academic job market, I'd like to ask just a couple of questions to get a better sense of who is all present in the audience. So those of you who are in a terminal master's program, would you be good enough to kind of raise your hand? Few of us. How about a PhD or doctoral program? Okay, many more folks there. And those of you who are present, how many of you are interested in pursuing an academic position? Wonderful, okay. And so my last question is, those of you who are present, does anyone here not like an interesting story? a good story that's like really interesting? No one. Okay, good. I was really concerned because I was ill prepared for a hand going up. And the reason why I asked this bizarre question, at least seemingly bizarre question, is because, like you and I, the majority of committee members who are on academic search committees like good stories. And so part of what I hope to do here is to speak a little bit about how you can think about your experiences and how to craft it into an interesting, engaging, and exciting story that other people, like the committee members at the university you hope to work in, can also get behind. So that being said, I'm going to steal part of my title from a well-known storyteller. And because you are all here in academia and seem to want to come back to academia at some point, I'll call this There and Back Again, Academics Tale. That being said, there are a few things that you should know. And the sooner you know them, the better off you will be when you actually start pursuing an academic position. And the first thing is yourself. Now, it's seemingly a short order. We all know ourselves, we love ourselves every day, but you need to do some soul searching before you even start the academic process and try to understand what your interests are, values, your strengths, and your weaknesses. And I'll talk a little bit about those in a moment. In addition, you want to think about who your audience is going to be. So who are these future committee members, and what are they going to look for in the application, in the story that you're going to tell? And finally, you want to think about what kind of a story are you going to craft using what you have available. And usually this would involve something along the lines of a cover letter, a teaching statement, which involves your philosophy of teaching experiences, your research statement, and a curriculum vitae, which sounds like you'll hear more about next week. And so I'll talk about all these things, and then hopefully the happily thereafter that happens if you successfully get through the initial process. So, first thing first. In clinical psychology, which is my background, there is this adage, the saying, clinician, know thyself. And this adage is true, I think, across disciplines, with the idea being that it's good to understand who you are, what your personality is like, what are your personal strengths and weaknesses, and what influences your decision-making process. If you understand this, you'll be much better off during the crafting of your story. For example, there's some very basic questions you might want to ask yourself before you even look for positions. And these include things like, why do you want to pursue a job in academia? Are you a masochist? Have you not had enough fun in graduate school? Why are you doing this to yourself? But in all seriousness, some folks have various motivations. And so, zoom tight, you might want to ask yourself, well, is this because you want fame and prestige? Is it because you want wealth? Is it because you have a passion for teaching and research? Is it because you're very curious? Is it because you're so used to academia that you cannot imagine a job in the real world? There is no wrong or right answer to this, but it is very important to have a sense of these things because knowing this will help you find a better fitting position for your specific interests and needs. Another question you might want to ask yourself is, where do you fall along the continuum of teaching and research? Are you someone who loves to be in front of students, really loves to help them learn, tries to get them to look at things from an interesting new angle, and really wants to get involved? Or are you someone who can't stand students and just wants to kind of ask these questions by yourself and, you know, write the grants, whatever? Again, there's no right or wrong answer, but knowing these things about yourself will help you better decide what positions to go for and how your experiences might play into telling a better story about yourself. Now, most academic positions involve some degree of both, but the leanings towards one end of the spectrum versus the other do change. And finally, it's important to know what your professional strengths, your values are. So it's important to understand if you are someone who wants to have a reasonable work-life balance. Do you not care and you're happy spending 18 hours a day in the office? What do you want to get out of things? Are you someone who's into a fast-paced, high-action environment? Do you want to have a lot of responsibility? Do you want to be the boss? Do you want to wear many different hats and do many different things? Or are you someone who wants a slower-paced lifestyle, maybe wear a given hat for a longer period of time? And I'll speak a bit more about what I mean as I talk about the different kinds of academic positions out there. And then finally, you need to understand what your professional strengths and weaknesses are. Because when you go on the job market, when you're telling your story, you need to be able to talk about what you've done in your graduate training. So what classes have you taught? What classes have you kind of taken a cursory role in? How many publications do you have? How many first authored, second authored? What tier of journals did you submit your publications to? And knowing this ahead of time will help you to use whatever time you have remaining in graduate school, and perhaps onward in postdoc, to beef up your weaknesses and know how to sell your strengths. Okay? Now, there's a diversity of disciplines here, and so the norms of publication teaching will vary across disciplines. However, there usually is some degree of minimal expectation for teaching experience as well as research productivity. Okay? So, knowing these things will help to guide you to various possible jobs. Know yourself. Know what you have going on, and you can proceed from there. Assuming that you have a sense of who you are and what you have to work with, the next question is, who will your audience be? To whom are you going to tell the story? And there are at least three broad audience groups. This is a simplification. There are more shades of gray than there are here, but I'll just talk about the three. First, you have the academic medical centers, where I think some of our panelists might be able to speak to more than I. But these are high-powered, top-tier, usually research institutions. There, the name of the game is grants, and there's a saying, you eat what you kill, which basically means that your survival there is dependent upon your ability to earn grant money. In fact, usually your salary, between 80 and 95%, comes from these monies that you're able to find. Because you're paying yourself, essentially, you get to be your own boss, and you hire people, and you have your own work, you know, lab, and you can do what you want. Publications are very important, but not for the sake of publishing, but because that's the only way you will be competitive for the next grant. So you might expect to spend 16 hours a day, 14 hours a day, writing a grant and being very thick-skinned and willing to accept the fact that less than 10% of applications get funded from the most brilliant minds in the US. So if that sounds like you and you want a cutting-edge, high, fast-paced career, fantastic. There are a lot of benefits. It pays well. So the lower end of the scale starts around $77,000, and it goes into hundreds of thousands of dollars. The longer you're there, the more prestige you have. Speaking of prestige, this is the place where you hear a lot of big names come from. So people who are in the news, in the media, they're the ones who often are in these top-tier research institutions. And they're doing cutting-edge research, and it's very exciting, and that might be something that's in line with your values. You work hard, and you reap the rewards. And because you're paying yourself, and you bring in millions of dollars, hopefully, you have a lot of autonomy. And so the administration will usually back off and say, hey, do what you do, just keep the money coming, and we'll take 55%+ off the top. Now, that may not be everyone's cup of tea because you're living a research lifestyle. And so you come in the morning and you leave sometime when the crow starts to, you know, let you know that it's morning again. You get a few hours of sleep and then you're back at it. And that may not be for everyone. Also, there is no security in that job. As soon as your grants go away, goodbye, so long, it's been swell. You clearly have outlived your shelf life. And so you will be asked to leave. And you are singularly responsible for other people's jobs. You hire staff. When your money goes, their jobs go. Their families will be out on the street, and it'll be all your fault. So that's why you need to write 18 hours a day. Now, my postdoctoral fellowship was at the University of Pittsburgh School of Medicine, which is one of these kinds of places. And so I had a wonderful opportunity to see what it's like from the inside. And I learned for myself that that's not necessarily my cup of tea, and so I chose not to pursue it, but other people might thrive in that environment. The next tier down is a research-focused institution. So think of Ohio State University, Brown, Duke, University of Pittsburgh, these kind of tier one research places. There, grant money is important. You need it to get tenure, but you have hard funds, and so you're paid whether or not you have a grant. You will not be kicked out, at least until the 5+ years run out and you don't have a grant, in which case, again, you're a poor fit. There, the focus is research for publications, so you're producing a lot of publications, usually between 2 and 3 a year, as a first author in a good journal. And you're teaching usually 1 to 2 classes a semester. If it's a more research-focused institution, about 1 class a semester. And also you're supervising students. And so here it's kind of more research with some teaching and mentorship involved. There are a lot of pros. You get paid a reasonable salary, and while it's less than in a medical center, you still get between 70s to 100 something thousand dollars a year. Prestige and fame can also come along with it. In fact, a lot of the books that we use to teach undergraduate courses are written by people at these kind of institutions. And you also have some degree of autonomy, as well as some hard fund support. The downside is, again, with top tier kind of research institutions, even in academic centers, it's long hours of writing, a long hours of balancing your research program with mentorship. And so that may or may not be your cup of tea. And you also need to get usually a grant to get tenure. And finally, you have the teaching folks institutions, of which I would probably place Cleveland State among. Because here the focus is on teaching, and generally in these places you teach and you strive to have engaged learning, as we do here, and it's between 2 and 3 classes a semester at a master's level, but perhaps 4 to 5 classes a semester at the smaller liberal arts schools and community colleges. So there it's much more teaching intensive, and if you love teaching, this might be the perfect place for you. Usually you'll still have to do research. For example, here the expectation is that you strive for grants. Whether or not you get them is okay. And you also publish. So you will not be kept here if you do not provide new knowledge in some way, shape, or form. So there are a lot of good things. Hard funds, love to teach, great. And there might be some support for you in terms of your research. The downside is you probably aren't gonna be famous. Sorry. And the financial scale also goes down. So usually it's between $40,000 and $80,000 a year. And this varies, of course, from institution to institution. I should also mention, depending upon the nature of your research, these teaching institutions may not be able to support it. So if you need to do brain scans, for example, with fMRIs, well, those are multi-hundreds, thousands, millions, perhaps dollars, or pieces of equipment that a place like CSU or a community college definitely will not have access to. So you need to kind of think about what it is you want to do research-wise and how well it fits what you want to do, okay? Now, assuming you have a sense of yourself and you know where to go, at least generally what kind of institution you want to strive for, where do you find these job offers? Where do you look for possibilities? By and large, you can look at whatever professional sites that you are involved in. So there are professional periodicals, there are websites. I list a few here, and I believe Patty will share this presentation with you, and so you'll be able to access them. And there are also professional listservs, such as for psychology, there's APS, ABCT, and slew other of acronyms that probably have no meaning to you that send out amongst themselves job openings. There are also informal wiki sites that have a host of open positions, and I'll just very, very quickly see if I can open this one here, just to kind of give you a sense of things. So I think you can see it, and this is for psychology positions, and there just is a slew of them, and they're listed by disciplines, and when the positions opened, and links to those positions, and so forth. But I'll let you guys take a look for yourselves. So, let's see if I can find my place, and I'll try to wrap it up, because I realize that I'm being long-winded here. Oh, resume presentation, perfect. Okay. So, let's assume that you know who you are, you know who your audience is. The next step is to tell your story, and I cannot emphasize this more. There is a mantra that you need to start chanting now, and it's never too early to start chanting it, and that is get more publications, get more independent research experience, and get more mentorship experience. These are the pieces of your story that you're going to have to highlight and emphasize to almost any position that you apply to various degrees, though, in terms of what you're doing research-wise versus teaching-wise. And you can use this mantra to help you build this coherent story about what you're about in terms of research, how you came to be the researcher that you are, where you're going, and how competent you are at it, your passion for teaching and mentoring students in both research and helping them to move on to the next step. And gosh, the more of this you do, the more pleased I suspect your advisors and potential letter writers are gonna be. And so you'll be able to leave no doubt in anyone's mind that you are a glowing, shining beacon of all things that academia needs, and they will write you wonderful letters that will help you get in. So if you're writing your story, it begins with your cover letter. And I want you to think about your cover letter as the book binding. So think about the last time you bought a book or read a book. You probably saw it, the picture looked interesting, you might have looked in the back, kind of saw what it's about and decided, do I want to even bother continuing to look at it further? This is what your cover letter is. So it needs to be very clean, cohesive, and very interesting. It captures you and all that you've done in graduate school and possibly during postdoc in 1 to 2 pages, which seems like, oh, that's a lot, but it's completely insufficient. So it's perhaps one of the hardest parts of writing the application, really capturing the core of who you are and your essence. And it is the perfect opportunity to promote yourself because you have to be an interesting story, and it's a wonderful time to promote your fit with that position. So you will look for ways of making your experiences fit with the needs of that job. Are they looking for a researcher? Are they looking for a teacher? Are they looking for someone who has a certain set of skills? And hopefully you'll be that someone. It'll involve a teaching statement, which will be not only your experiences as a teacher, but also your philosophy of what it means to teach. So why do we do the things that we do? What is your view of what students should get out of the experience of being in academia? And through what means will you do it? I should mention that across your storytelling, you need to be as detailed as possible, use examples from your life and your experiences, and really kind of make a coherent picture come out. So it's not only about your experiences, but pedagogy, and given the changing face of the classroom, it's about cultural competence as well. How have you interacted with diverse students from cultural backgrounds, ethnic backgrounds, and sexual orientations, within your classroom. How did you manage these various dynamics? Very important, particularly for teaching-focused institutions. Your research statement is usually requested as well, even in teaching institutions, because there is always some degree of research involved. And here you're synthesizing all of your work and telling a story of how you started your research interests, how you came to be where you are now, and where it's going. And the cleaner your story is, the clearer your arc is, the better off you are. And so what they want to gain is a sense of your competence as a researcher and your potential to develop further on, including, particularly in research institutions, your ability to get grant money. For teaching institutions, most importantly, you will use this to sell how you're going to bring students into the research experience. How will you mentor them? How will you encapsulate their interests and create a new wave of individuals who might be academicians as they go on? For those of you who are doing research that's kind of cutting edge, you'll have to explain how you'll be able to do it at whatever institution you go, especially if it's a smaller institution where they may not have the resources to support fMRIs or other kinds of machines. And finally, your curriculum vitae is just simply almost a bulleted product of your teaching and also your research. It's just a simple, here's the black and white, what I've done, and it needs to look professional, it needs to look clean, and it needs to look simple. Think of it almost a table of contents for someone to quickly look through and get a bird's eye view of you in a moment, okay? And it sounds like you'll be again talking about that later on. So assuming there's a happy ending and you have now applied to the places where you have and they want to hear more about you, they will give you a call, and usually it involves a 10 or 15 minute phone interview with the committee that'll ask you broad questions and kind of get a sense of whether you are completely socially inept and don't know how to speak on the phone, or if you're someone they might be more interested in hearing from, at which point they'll invite you to come in and it'll involve some kind of a job talk involving both a teaching element as well as a research component. You'll probably meet faculty, students, deans, whomever. And assuming that all is beautiful and they love you, the hard part really begins, because then they'll extend an offer and you have to make a decision. Is this a reasonable place for me to be? And can I negotiate a reasonable living wage, the facilities that I need, and whatever else is involved for you to be successful there? And I'll tell you just a moment of my own personal experience where I got two offers, including Cleveland State. One was in a beautiful place on the West Coast, California, right by the beach. It was lovely. And Cleveland, which was wonderful as well. And
also on the beach.
Also on the beach. Thank you. So basically the same place. one less sunny than the other. But the amount of money that was offered was identical. And not because they didn't want to get more, but because there are certain standards in terms of how much an institution can afford to pay you. So you need to make a very informed decision about what it is you're willing to sacrifice to be where you want to be, and considering family ties, considering personal desires, and the potential to succeed where you go, you have a lot of hard thinking to do. But it's better to be there than not to be there at all. So that being said, I think that's about it. I probably have made you go somewhere along this scale. Hopefully you're not beyond 11 and closer to 11 than like Spinal Tap. But if you are distressed, that's okay. Just take deep diaphragmatic breaths. And remember, if you don't have the experiences that you need now, you will have time to do those in a postdoctoral fellowship. So if you're not ready for the job market, get a postdoc, and it'll give you the breathing room you need to develop this research repertoires and buttress any kind of weaknesses that you might have in your current application. All right, and I think that's all I'm going to say. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Wilson. I'm going to interrupt for one moment to have a technical check. We are microphoned in here. I just want to make sure that we're picking everything up, because I don't think everything's okay. All right, good. Can everyone in the back hear us clearly?
You may want to move that, though.
Yeah.
The proverbial mic.
Okay, then we'll move on. And also, as Dr. Yaroslavsky mentioned, in case I forget, if we run a little bit over, we will have all of these materials. There's some great comprehensive resources in here, and you can spend, you know, hours at some of these sites. We will be posting this to our website after the fact. As I said, our next session is April 27th, so after that point, the website should be
completely updated that will include some of these links, some of these PowerPoints, so you can go back to use them as a reference also. So we'll continue now with Dr. Julia Phillips.
Thank you, and thank you, Dr. Yaroslavsky, for the wonderful, I think, overview of the job search process and for the idea of telling a good story, because I think that that is a really important piece to, or frame to, keep in mind as you move from the beginning of your graduate program through the end, as you move to that point where you actually will be sending out your applications. I will share a little bit about my own personal pathway and tell some stories that hopefully will also illustrate some of those ideas and offer some pieces of advice about the process that hopefully will be helpful for you. So I went to Ohio State back in the olden days, in the late 1980s and early 1990s. And as they say, you always research what is me-search, so you research what's interesting to you. And so I decided that I was going to do my dissertation on the concept of research self-efficacy, also being a psychologist and in the field. So research self-efficacy is how much, essentially, self-confidence do you have in doing research, and how is that related to the research training that your program provides. And of course, in psychology, one thing that those of you who are outside the field may not be aware of is that we train our students from what's called a scientist practitioner model. And so we train them to be both scientists and practitioners, and ideally, everybody who goes out into the workforce will have elements of both science and practice in their identities. Now, often what happens, and in their practice, what often happens is that we have people who go into research, and we have people who go into practice, and never the two shall meet in many ways. So I actually was somebody who was not interested in being in academia while in graduate school because I saw it as an extended graduate school life. I didn't want to feel like I was in graduate school the rest of my life and had a paper to write every waking moment. And so I thought I'd go and get a real job. And that's what I did. I went into practice in university counseling centers. But I also really valued the scientist practitioner model. And I had done this research on research self-efficacy and had increased my own sense of research self-efficacy. And as I was at my dissertation defense, my three academic professors at the Research One institution asked me if I had any plans on doing research as I was going into this counseling center practice job. And I said, oh yes, I do. I plan on doing research and I plan on publishing. And they kind of giggled and laughed at me, thinking this was not really going to happen. And they said, oh really, okay, well, how much do you think you're going to publish? And I said, well, I think I'll publish, my goal will be that I'll publish one thing a year. And then they didn't giggle at all. They laughed out loud. I mean, it was an owl and owl out laugh. And I'm kind of sitting there a little stymied as a naive student thinking, didn't you all train me for the last 5 years in a scientist practitioner model? This doesn't make sense to me. But that moment stuck with me, and that always had been my goal, was to do some scholarship and contribute to the literature. So as I went into my practice jobs, I continued to do research, do scholarship, and publish. And I kind of met my goal of doing one publication a year for the next 20 some years of my career. And that actually set me up for being able to make the jump to academia. So one thing that is important, I think, in thinking about an alternative career path is the idea that you don't necessarily have to go into an academic job the first job you get right out of graduate school, but you do have to continue doing the types of activities that academia expects from you. And you may not go into the academic job that you expect to go into, but again, continue to do the types of activities that are expected, even if it's above and beyond. So you may end up teaching at a more teaching-focused institution, even though you're aspire to a research institution. Well, you're still going to be teaching maybe 3 and 3 or 4 and 4, but do your research on the weekends and, you know, work 80 or 90 hours a week so that you set yourself up for that job that you really want. And you can do it in different ways, figuring out different pathways. The other thing is that, realistically speaking, academic jobs aren't easy to get. And in fact, I don't think jobs are easy to get, frankly. And I know that as I looked at even jobs in university counseling centers for psychologists outside of graduate school, even coming from one of the top programs in the country, I applied to 45 jobs across the country, across the nation. I interviewed for 5 and I had one offer in hand. And at that point I said, I think I'll take this offer. And I ended up in Lubbock, Texas for 2 years. Which was a learning experience for me. It was not my top choice of where I wanted to be, geographically speaking, but again, it set me up for then being able to come back to Northeast Ohio, which was home, and being in the training environment that I wanted to be in. So kind of recognize that there also may need to be flexibility with respect to kind of where you want to be and that path that you take to get there, but remembering that you need to always kind of keep your eye on the prize of what do you want 3 to 5 years, you know, 7 to 10 years down the road, so that you're doing the types of things that you need to do. With respect to what you are doing now, thinking about those things and making sure that you get those opportunities is really important. So if you're really interested in teaching, get teaching experience. Figure out how you can be both a teaching assistant to professors as well as having independent teaching where you are the instructor of the classroom. Some departments that may not be possible, so you may need to look at, are there other departments on campus or areas that you could be teaching? And really explore that. Or are there even other universities or community colleges in the area that you could get an adjunct position and get that experience? So making sure that you think about the type of job that you want, the type of experience those people sitting on that search committee are going to be looking for, and make sure that you get that on your vita. For research-focused institutions, it is all about publications, and it is all about research. So you're going to want to be working on the publications and the research that your professors are working on so that you can maybe be the second or third or fourth, even sometimes fifth or sixth author. And then you also are going to want to figure out how can you start some independent projects and start crafting your own line of research, which likely will be related to your professors so that they can give you guidance. This really does have to do with mentoring, and in graduate school I had great professors. I think that they also kind of looked at people who are going into practice positions as, well, they're just going into practice, they don't need that much mentoring, to be honest. And I was pretty independent and could figure things out on my own, and so I didn't seek it out. And so what I would really suggest is that you make sure that you seek out mentoring and ask for what you need. And even if it feels like uncomfortable asking for what you need, start the conversation about, hey, I'm a little uncomfortable about having this conversation, but I want to have this conversation about what I need and how I can get it. I think also thinking about mentors who can help you at different levels and in different ways. Then we always think of our traditional mentor as that professor who is the older, wiser one who is going to impart the wisdom and share with us and support us and always be there 100% of the time. Sometimes that becomes a more personal relationship as well. But that may not happen. You may have to have mentors who you may have to have a teaching mentor, a research mentor, and then kind of more of a social emotional support mentor. Also think about peer mentors and looking for people in your program who can be peers. Maybe they may be in your same cohort, or they may be a couple years or a year ahead of you. So people who can really support you. And may, perhaps that you start a research project you do posters with, you might co-teach a class with, for example. I also love the idea that Dr. Melba Vasquez talked about in terms of, she's a psychologist, past president of the American Psychological Association. She's the first Latina president of APA. And she talked about the reality, especially for people of color and for women, that you may not have connections to people in your immediate program who can mentor you, who look like you, and so, and who think like you, who act like you, and who know your culture. And so if this is for you, sometimes you need to look to what she called mentors from afar, and thinking about where are some mentors from afar, meeting people at conferences, for example, that can provide support. They're not going to be mentors in the way that you think of the traditional mentors, but even having kind words, getting kind support, getting a snippet of advice, sending an email here and there, back and forth, even reading their work as role models and knowing that they're out there can be very empowering, particularly if you are a minority of some type in a program. I think that can be really important. So mentoring, I think, is important. And it's also important to have realistic ideas about kind of what different mentors can be and how they can be helpful, and talk openly with them about that. Some other ideas about kind of search advice, I think, relates to that idea of going to conferences. As a graduate student, I didn't go to any conferences beyond kind of regional conferences. And that was because none of my faculty really emphasized to me that it's worth your $1,000 to go to a conference. And I thought to myself, well, if I'm gonna spend $1,000, I think I'm gonna go to Florida. You know, and nobody real, honestly, nobody really said to me, like, you know, this is really important. So I kind of missed out in that way. But now I look at it, I've gone to APA every single year, save last year, because I broke my ankle and was literally on the couch during APA. But it is such a good experience in terms of the networking that you can do, the leadership development that you can do. Many of my publications and my scholarship have arisen from projects that have started with people from mentoring, from networking, from conferences, from leadership activities that I've done in the national arena. So get involved in the national arena. Of course, make wise choices about the service that you do, but the more you can get out there and get your name known at the national, in a national organization professionally, when your application comes across the desk, they say, oh yes, this was, you know, Julia Phillips, who was, you know, served on this committee, and she showed up, she did a good job, and she was the type of person that people like to work with. And that's what people are looking for. Of course, you've got to have your credentials, but you also need to have, and you need to have your publications and your experiences and all your materials in order, but you, those personal connections make a difference. So I'll end there and say thank you very much.
So I teach at a small, what we call principally undergraduate institution, liberal arts college, except we do have master's programs in different departments. That was not my goal to get there 25 years ago. I started out in graduate school working for a group where every single person got an industrial job. interviewed for a number of those at Duke, which had a very strong industrial program where companies came in and interviewed, and the economy wasn't the best. And so I ended up taking a postdoc in Rhode Island. And that was good because I got a chance to do research in another person's lab. It was similar research, but not quite the same. I was fairly independent in graduate school and as a postdoc, so that got a chance to just do something a little bit different, but still in the realm. Then it came time to try and find employment. And 20 years ago, there was no internet to apply for jobs. There was stacks of letters and stamps and never hearing things.
Yes.
I think I interviewed for one job in South Carolina, got there, and within the first 5 minutes, oh, you should be interviewing for this job. Well, that would have been helpful to know that ahead of time. But I ended up then looking at academic jobs and had a few of those. Now, in graduate school, I was a TA for 1 year, my first year there, and then I was supported on grants. So I had a number of publications, but no teaching experience. And so when they first put me in a room of undergraduate students, I think at St. Joe's in Philadelphia, that was kind of awkward as we all sat around and looked at each other, because I wasn't used to undergraduate students. And so it was clear I wasn't prepared to, you know, walk into the classroom and teach. I took a teaching position at Kansas State, so I moved from Rhode Island to the exact dead center of the country, Manhattan, Kansas, and started there. Syllabus from the previous person was on the bulletin board outside the door, and that's how I wrote my first syllabus. A far cry from today, where there's websites on how to do it and videos. But what I found was that I was in a primarily undergraduate teaching role at a Division I university. And there's a role for those types of instructors there. I was a visiting assistant professor at the time. And, you know, I had a class of 100 students or so. And so it gave me a lot of face-to-face time with the students. I found out I could do that. I had patience for it, to sit down with students to help them learn organic chemistry, which isn't exactly the easiest, nor has the best reputation of the chemistries, particularly among doctors. But going through that face-to-face with the students was really, you know, it taught me, okay, I can do this. 1 year experience wasn't enough, so I actually took a second visiting position at Ohio University. And so I grew up in Western Pennsylvania. It got me closer to home. And then down there, I taught basically the same kinds of classes, but I became more comfortable, began to, you know, expand my teaching, maybe try a few different pedagogies. Wasn't really involved with research other than maybe some postdoctoral work with my postdoctoral boss, where I had some time off. I'd go to Brown and do some things. And I've interviewed probably at about 30 different colleges. That thing you put up, I'm like, oh, I interviewed about 5 places just on your little thing. One of the things as you're kind of preparing for that is you really, to get a teaching job at a smaller college like ours, and we're in the process right now of hiring a visiting assistant professor. The people that rise to the top of the list have some teaching experience. Sometimes they have a lot of teaching experience. The last person we hired had 8 years of teaching experience and was tenured in another university. You can't compete against them. But having the teaching experience is important, particularly if you're going to go to a smaller school where the emphasis is on teaching. Now, how you get that? As much as you can in your graduate career. We have students that have gone to Ohio State, one in particular, who didn't have a lot of teaching experience, really wanted to teach at a small school like us. And and the advice was, we'll try and find in your postdoc a place to be able to do that teaching, to get maybe a part-time job in the university or maybe in a smaller one. And I know in his case that that's really helped him, because I know he interviewed at Malone College a few weeks ago for a job. So you have to have teaching experience of some sort. Now, how you sell that, having more classroom teaching experience is really useful. But in my case, I had none of that, so I had to spend a couple of years in visiting positions in order to get that teaching experience to then, you know, get the position that I have today. So that's one thing, to try and get the teaching experience as much as you can, even if it's recitation sessions, whatever possibilities you have. As far as, you know, research at an undergraduate institution, I don't think you could get tenure without a research publication, even at a very small school. Our expectations are about one publication every 3 years. In some departments like ours, we are expected to work hand in hand with undergraduate students. Now, we view undergraduate research a little bit differently. Ours is a form of teaching. And so it's not only to give the student the pure research experience, but to teach them about research, so that when our students go to Ohio State, they don't feel lost, that they have some of that experience. And so you do have to keep the research, your research plans, think about them. One thing that I would tell younger people is, they're thinking about it, is collaboration, I think, is incredibly important when you're at a smaller school. The ability to collaborate with maybe your postdoctoral or your research advisor. Around here, obviously, at John Carroll, we are surrounded by the Cleveland Clinic and Case and Akron. So as far as instrumentation, we have the ability to work with those institutions and have collaborations with people at the clinic. Even people at Youngstown State have instruments that I've had used, because we don't have them. But collaboration is important, and as you go through your career, so keeping those intact is very useful. In a primarily teaching institution, particularly nowadays, it's, I think, important to have some knowledge of what the scholarship of teaching involves. Like I said, I took the syllabus off the bulletin board. I had no idea how to write the syllabus. It's only been in the last couple of years that I've really studied in depthly what learning outcomes are and all of the assessment words. And we are right now at our university going through some assessment pains. But I think having that, or just beginning to see that lingo and learn it and the process, I think is important, because, you know, higher education is changing. Maybe not so much at the bigger schools, but it is at the smaller schools. Accreditation, it is changing. And I don't know what it would be like in 15 years, because with the advent of technology and this, the accreditation responsibility that's going on with that. So what you know about that, or if you spend a little bit of time, go to the Chronicle of Higher Education, see what the hot button issues are. You know, will we have degrees in 15 years, or will everybody have badges and certificates? I can't necessarily see colleges being that way, but seeing what's going on in basically an industry that you're going to join, or that you want to join, seeing where the trends are. I mean, things move very slowly in academics, almost as slow as government, but they move very slowly. But there are, you know, it is changing. And so kind of taking some time to look at that as well. You know, teaching philosophies, there's many websites. There are some excellent ones. I think you have one of the sheets that I spent an hour on the computer just finding some. Vanderbilt has a very good one. The Eberly Center at Carnegie Mellon. You could literally spend a day just looking at all of this as far as, you know, just the teaching aspect goes. And that is important, you know, at a smaller school, again, the teaching is what we're sort of, it's what our bread and butter is. And so having that experience. I didn't intend to go and teach at a small school. I kind of ended up there. My dream job was Xavier. Guy called me on the phone and said, Mike, there's a place for you, but it's not here. It ended up a year later being at John Carroll, both Jesuit schools, both highly committed to service. That's one aspect that I think the bigger schools have embraced that, but the smaller schools, it's always been a signature element. And so in, you know, at a place like John Carroll, service is ingrained with us. Where do you fit in that? You know, what kinds of service are you involved with? And again, that kind of fits your talents and what your experience is, what your interests are, and service also within the university itself. I just came from committee meetings and going through policies, and sometimes you have to get involved in that. As a young faculty, it's probably not too bad to begin to hear about those things if it doesn't turn you off for the rest of your career. But just keeping, you know, just doing the service that way. And really in our positions at smaller schools, it is teaching first, then research and service. Sometimes the research and service are equivalent. So it's a slightly different position than what you would have at a bigger school with the people where you were teaching masters or PhD students, but really the focus is on teaching. And so experience you can get, the knowledge that you can get about it are really helpful in terms of trying to secure those positions, even if it's an extra year or a non-traditional experience. So that's the advice I would give.
Thank you, Dr. And next we'll move on to Dr. Kopali and set up his slides.
So thanks for giving the opportunity to talk here. So my approach to academics is slightly different from what we heard from the panel. So I did my undergraduate in India, and before I came to US, I knew what I want. The reason being my dad is an academician, my uncles are academicians, both in India and abroad. I have two uncles who are faculty in US. So I know on day one what I want. And so the next 10 years I spent building up my resume. And I'm gonna show you some examples of what I did. So I had my background in chemical engineering, and that was way back in India. And then I did double masters in chemical and material science. I got my PhD and postdoc. At every stage, what you see here, I have been building consciously one aspect of my resume. So for example, during my masters, I was trying to build up my publications. So I had almost 4 to 5 papers before I finished my master's. And then I went to PhD. I consciously wanted to be a teaching assistant and not a research assistant, even though there is funding in the lab to allow me to do research. And I taught, co-taught a couple of courses. I was a teaching assistant for a couple of courses. And once I'm done with my PhD, I need a big name on my CV. Pedigree matters. You may deny that, but it really matters. So if you look at people, we are from Duke, Ohio State. So it really matters where you went, where your degrees are from, or at least where your training is from. So I went to MIT. It's an independent postdoc where I got funding from industry for 3 years, no strings attached. So I was a freelance postdoc at that point. So I did my postdoc 3 years, and I kind of got that brand name. So I started applying for positions. This was in 2010. And I applied to approximately 34 schools, and they were all over the place. I was applying to government labs, I was applying to universities, I was applying to in both US and Europe, wherever I see a position. And they were in different departments, and finally I got approximately 11 phone interviews. I had 5 on-site interviews, and CSU was the first one to offer me the position. It was a tenure track position. I was really excited and thrilled. And then Cornell Medical School came back, I interviewed there, they said they're gonna offer a position. But as you heard from one of the faculty here, that was a non-tenure track. They can kick me out anytime. There is no job security. And I need to bring my own money to support my salary, my students, my lab. I don't want that with a new baby in the house. I don't want that insecurity. And I took CSU offer, and 1 month down the line, Wisconsin-Madison calls and they tell that they have some interest in me and they wanted to know if I'm still available. Too little, too late, so I didn't go for that. But no regrets, so I'm glad I'm here. So these are some of the links I browsed when I was looking for positions. So again, this is not a comprehensive deal, but you know, you can see for some of these links. I did circulate a handout of this talk, so you don't need to write them down. They are all in the handout. So in addition to these websites, you may want to be in contact with your department chair. They get a lot of those emails they can forward. You need to let people know in your department that you are interested in academics. They won't know on their own. So if you are a doctoral student, go to your department chair, go to your senior faculty, tell them that you are interested in academics. Ask them to share any information they can with you. And when you go to conferences, there are these notice boards where they put the advertisements, open positions. So you may want to look at that. And finally, you want to network. So when you go to conferences, take visiting cards, just give it to people, you know. They may not look at it immediately. They go back to their work, and then they pull out this from the wallet, and they're like, okay, yeah, you know. So they add you to their to their LinkedIn or to their, you know, email list. They keep in touch, so network with people. So in your first year of graduate school, you may want to be honest to yourself. Take a pen, write down what your strengths are, what your weaknesses are. And be brutally honest to yourself. Don't exaggerate your abilities. Don't play down your strengths. And once you do that, the next thing is try to sharpen your strengths. Try to reinforce them. Try to improve on them. And what I did was I identified my weaknesses and I started working on them. I started interacting with junior faculty. I started interacting with senior professors to see what they have to tell me. Go to lunch with the junior most faculty in your department. You will learn a lot. So once you do that, then you need to identify what kind of job you want. I'm not gonna go in details, we already talked about it. But if you want a position where there is both research and teaching, those jobs are very few. I think in your field, you may see maybe 5 jobs in a year, not more than that. So you start looking at the periphery, you may see more. Overlapping field in the periphery. And so when I applied, so this was the tentative timeline. I think this applies to majority of the positions. So you want to start preparing 1 year in advance before you want to apply. Start writing down. You will realize how hard it is to write down one page of statement of purpose. It could be teaching, it could be research, it could be about yourself. The most hardest thing to do is write about yourself one page. And it just be really shameless, you know. Identify your strength, identify your weakness, tell what you are good at, tell what you are not good at. And majority of the applications are posted in the fall, so you may want to keep an eye on all the links you saw. I do see a lot of these positions posted on LinkedIn, so don't ignore that. It's a free, I'm shamelessly promoting it. So it's a free portal. Go there, sign up, have your profile there. A lot of people will look at it. You will be surprised the kind of responses you get. There are a lot of positions posted there, so keep browsing. attend some of the meetings in the fall and spring in your own field, or, you know, and try to network, talk to people, let them know that you applied. When you see a chair of the department, let them know what you are working on, and then tell them that you are interested in their department to apply out there. And majority of the interviews are between December and March. That includes phone interviews, that includes on-site. And you will have your negotiations from March to May most of the time. Sometimes there is a little bit of give or take, but the positions typically start in August, but that's negotiable. If you tell, I need 4 more months to wrap up my work, they're gonna wait. They're not gonna withdraw the offer. So you can always start in January if you want. So, but the goal is, don't send in an application which you are not convinced yourself. Really put your thought, your heart, your soul, read it 10 times, show it to people, get feedback, and then apply. If you are not convinced, don't assume the search company is gonna be happy. So I'm just gonna provide some information. Your CV should be as detailed as possible. Use really big font. Really put all the information there, what you did, what you got, what you are good at, everything. And the research plan depends on the department. In my field, you have to write 5-page research plan most of the time. And they want 1 page for each project you want to work on. So 3 pages for 3 projects, 2 pages generic write-up. So you want to propose what idea you want to work on, why it is different, why it is novel, and what you are gonna do about it. You don't need to tell in detail that in the first month I'm gonna do this, in the first year I'm gonna do it, but tell people what is it you are excited about. And you need to really carefully articulate that. Teaching statement, 1 to 2 pages. Many people write a generic teaching statement and send it out. That's not gonna cut the deal. You need to tell what courses you are TA, what courses you co-taught. Maybe it may be invited lecture, but tell clearly the feedback you got. What did students say? What did your peers say? What did your mentors say? That's really important. And you can use that all as like a small paragraph or an appendix or something. And references are very important. And any other portfolio, typically your publications, any conference proceedings or any other awards or things. And look for typos. I sit on many search committees. I see hundreds of typos. They didn't read through it. They didn't check it out. Look for every word. Don't rely on word check. That's gonna cheat you. You are not gonna get a job if you rely on that. Give a copy to everyone in your department. Ask them to read it. Your wife, your mom, your spouse, whoever it is. So just make sure you don't have any typos. How do you stand out? For every position at CSU we are interviewing, we get approximately 150 to 200 applications. Why do they need to select you? Why should they select you? So you need to have something which no one else has. So you need to read in between the lines in the job posting. No one is gonna tell, we are looking for a star in this field. No one is gonna tell, that's a problem legally, and you're shooting yourself, because you are gonna get only 5 applications at that point. So to satisfy all the HR needs, all your needs, you know, all the search committee needs, you are gonna keep the position as broad as possible. You are gonna tell, we are looking in general chemical engineering. So you are gonna get 200 applications, and it's the search committee's job to really bring it down. They are not gonna tell you what they are looking for, but they know that. So read between the line, and go to the department website, wherever you are applying. Spend some time, get to know the people. There may be people you already know. There may be people who your advisor knows. There may be people you met in a conference. So go there, browse, get to know people. And you may want to boost up your productivity. That is something which is becoming more and more important. When I sent in my application, I had 23 first order publications. And I did not make the shortlist at majority of the schools. There are a lot of candidates who have very good publications. If you have 2 papers in your field and the norm is 8, that's not gonna cut the deal. If you have 2 papers in your field and you are in economics, you are a star, because no one has that many publications, right? I mean, you are a god in the field, and they're like, wow, 2 publications this candidate has. But in my field, 2 publications, you are not gonna get even a phone call. I mean, forget about it. And you need to have them in really good journals in your field. If there is no impact factor for the journal, don't even think of submitting there. You want to have very good impact in the field. They are also going to look at a bunch of other things which I listed here. But the bottom line is you need to be diversified. What you think is hot right now may not be 5 years down the line, 10 years down the line. The funding agencies have different criteria every 5 years down the line. So you want to make sure that you have a very diverse portfolio. If you look at my background, for example, I had background in chemical, materials, biomedical, biological. I can do an experiment in 4 different fields. So that is something which many departments found interesting and they thought I'm diversified. I can apply for research funding in different areas. If you are looking in teaching, you want to see what the core curriculum is and can you teach that. How many courses can you teach in your department right now if you are a PhD student? And if you are not so comfortable or confident, talk to the faculty who is teaching a course. Volunteer to teach one class every semester. In the next semester, 2 classes. So many people will be happy. I do let PhD students in my department teach a class in my course. I learn something new. They overcome stage fear. They know how to prepare slides. So that's a very good approach to co-teach a course, 1 or 2 classes, not more than that. And depending on which field you are in, if you are in sciences or engineering or you know some of these areas, you need to be able to bring in money. That's the bottom line. Even CSU is consciously moving towards that direction because that's how you raise funds, that's how you build buildings, that's how you get patent, that's how you get money. So purely teaching alone is not going to cut the deal at many departments anymore. You need to be able to do research and bring in money. And finally, pedigree matters. Again, do at least 1 year a postdoc or a visiting position, whatever it is, depending on your field, in a very good school. And once you really made the deal, once you are in the top 5 or top 10, they're going to call you for interview. Before they call you on campus, they're going to have a phone interview. They're going to make sure that you are really the candidate they want. And so at this point, it's going to be more about you. What do you know? What can you teach? What can you work? And what can you bring to the department? And how can the department help you in achieving your goals? So you are going to have a series of meetings. So be prepared for that. You are going to meet at least 15 to 20 people, depending on the department size. When I came here, I interviewed 1 day at CSU and 1 day at Cleveland Clinic. I was meeting clinicians, I was meeting administrators, I was meeting faculty in the department, deans. So it was a brutally rigorous 2-day session. Be prepared for that. Don't wear the same suit 2 days. Change your suit. And be prepared, you know, be prepared to talk to different kind of audiences. Don't have a set of talking lines and then repeat the same thing in every office, you know. It could be dangerous if you are sarcastic. If you land in Cleveland in December and talk about how many vitamin D pills you need to take every day, that's not going to go well. So you need to be careful about your jokes, your sarcasm, your audience, and everything. So, and don't whine. If your flight is delayed, so be it. That's not search committee's problem. Don't tell about how long you waited in the airport, how there is no Panera bread around, you know. It's not going to cut the deal. And be prepared to have different kinds of talks. Not everyone is interested in your research. People want to know about how you are about teaching. You know, so it's going to be just the students and you, no one else. And you're going to meet with the department chair mostly towards the end, and then he or she is going to tell you what is expected in that position and what is the timeline going forward. These are some of the tips for the interview day. And you know, these are some mistakes which everyone does. I have seen a candidate who came for interview constantly checking the emails on the phone. And I'm talking to him in my room. He said, Nira, that doesn't go well. So, and feel free to tell people who you know. Oh, I know that professor, I read his publication, I know this lady, I met her in a conference. Drop in names, that's really gonna help. And don't tell that Bill Clinton is your friend or something. That's going to cut the deal. So know your limits, but clearly tell people that you are connected in the field. You know, so that's very important. and take copy of your resume. Don't expect senior professors to have your resume on their table when you walk in. You are not something that important to them that day. They have other problems to worry about. So take your resume, volunteer. In case you don't have it, just take it. They can look at it and then they can talk more, you know. So there are many ways you can kill an interview. This is something which came on top of my list. But again, don't crack jokes, don't be sarcastic. At the same time, don't be super shy. Don't be too afraid to talk. Just talk normally, that's okay. And don't have self-indulgence. I did this, you know, I only discovered it, and back in those days, no one cares. Even the person interviewing you did something. That's the reason why he is there or she is there. So have some respect for what other people did, but at the same time, make sure that you are not downplaying yourself. So once you are done with the interview, you go back, send an email, follow up. If you don't, they think you are not interested. They think this is your backup option, not your primary option. When you go back, take a day or two, but do send an email to everyone you talk with. If you had something to follow up, if you promise them you'll send your publication, do that. That tells you are interested, you are a people person, and you follow up things. And that's very crucial when you join the job. If you don't follow up things, your colleagues will lose interest in you on day two, right? So that's very important. And so the committee meets up, and this is all behind the scenes. You don't get to see all this stuff. The committee meets, they rank their candidates. Don't assume that you have 15 publications, you are going to be the number one. It doesn't matter. We ended up recruiting people who have less publication, but who have more relevant background or relevant teaching experience. So this is the way they proceed. You know, it's going to go all the way to provost. They make their choice. And don't call or email every 2 days. I know you are nervous, everyone goes through that, but give it a rest, you know, don't follow up. Wait 1 month, 2 months, and then send an email if you don't hear. And if you haven't heard, you have already heard about it, right? So bottom line is be patient, you know, don't think about it 24/7, just do other things, distract your mind, let it go. Just assume that it's a very good experience you had, move on. And if you are selected, you are going to get a call. So, you know, everyone is looking forward to that. You work 10 years, your butt off to get that phone call, honestly, right? So don't be excited and jump and drop the phone. Talk very coolly. You don't know what they're calling you about. And most of the time, you don't even recognize the number. So don't think it's a spam. Pick it up and then talk, you know. So when I interviewed, the dean of engineering called me. And it was a very polite conversation. He wanted to know if I'm still available, and he wanted to know if that is the right time to talk. You know, so they're very polite. They have a certain mannerisms. And don't tell yes on the phone and jump in joy. Just tell that, thank you very much. You know, I want to see everything in writing and stuff like that. And wait till you get the actual document. Go through every line. Show it to your advisor. Show it to your peers. So this is what is included in the offer letter typically, your 9 month salary. Unless you are in a medical school or something, they're going to promise 9 month salary. So that is what academic job is. And sometimes, depending on where you are, they'll promise some summer support. And this is a typical package. So it depends on the field. If you are in engineering or science, these are the numbers you want to see. These are the information you want to see. And how many students are they going to support? And you know, what is your teaching load and all those things. And ask for a mentor. If you don't get one in writing, ask for one. So you are establishing a relationship at that point, and that person is going to guide you for the first 6 years of your career and maybe beyond. Get everything in writing. So public memory is short. What they tell today, they don't probably remember tomorrow. They may be interviewing or they may be recruiting 5 people for 5 different positions, right? So they don't remember what they told you on phone. Get it in writing. Once it is in writing, that is legally binding. You are going to get it. You are going to make sure you are going to get it. And most of the things are negotiable. Mostly salary, don't negotiate. There is a reason why they gave you that number. So the first rookie mistake is, oh, you are giving me 72K. I want 82K. They don't have that money. If they have, they're going to put it there. So you may have probably maybe 4 to 5% wiggle room, not more than that. 10%, 20%, it's not going to happen. And so these are the things you can really negotiate. How much lab space you are going to get, how many students you are going to get, what's your teaching load, can you reduce that? So there are some things you can negotiate. So do your homework, talk to people, and don't lowball yourself. Don't just blindly go with the numbers they propose. They will think you are cheap to get. So don't do that. At the same time, don't double the things. You know, so if they give you 300,000 in startup, go for 400,000, not 800,000 or 700,000. You are not gonna get that. And make sure you get everything in writing before you sign on the dotted line. Once you sign, that is it. They don't care. You become one of them now. So they don't care. That's all you get. That's it. And don't have a moving goalpost. So if you tell this week, this is what I want, they match that. Next week, don't tell I want more. You are going to lose your respect at that point, your credibility at that point. And this is the bottom line. You need to take a step back and think about what you want and how close is the offer to that. If you think it is realistically close, there may be other factors, your spouse, job, your, you know, whatever it is. So, but everything should add up. And there is a myth that if you negotiate, they're gonna retract the offer. That doesn't happen. Once they extend an offer, they are in the game. They are in the water. They will go as deep as it can get. So they want to negotiate. They really want you at that point. So go with that mindset. And every request you do, don't tell on the phone, because the words get lost, words get changed, whatever. Send an email, put everything in writing, do your homework. And once you accept, don't retract. There are numerous stories online. When you talk to people, you will know. You accept an offer and you retract, you are burning bridges. And that goes deep. People get pissed off when you do that. So don't, because they invested time, they invested money, they invested resources on you, so don't do that. And old grudges die hard, that's John Adams saying. So people thought about it 200 years back, so, you know, so this is nothing new. And ask for other forms. If you want parking very close to your building, you can ask that, you know? So, you know, whatever is the reason. And you can ask for other things, tuition for family, you know, whatever it is needed. So if you don't ask, they don't tell, right? It may take months for you to know what is available to you. So get everything to know, get everything in writing, and ask for help. Now, the obvious question is, what is it that is involved in your tenure process? So once you accept, that's not end of the story. That's the beginning of the story. You have 6 more years to get your tenure, to make sure that your job is secure and safe, and you're going to continue there for the rest of your life. You want to know what the tenure rate is. How many junior faculty were kicked out? Not at a school like CSU, unless you do something stupid, but at a big school, right? In big schools, they recruit 2 to 3 people for every position, and that's the truth. They are going to kick you out. So the hypothesis going forward is you are not going to be there 6 years down the line. If you made it, you survived, good for you. They don't care. But the smaller schools, they invest in you. They really want you to grow. They really want you to succeed so that they can succeed. So you need to ask, can I go for early tenure? How early can I go? If I bring a $1 million grant, can I go 2 years in advance? You need to know all these things before you go. And you want to know what is the formula they use to increase salary. Are you not gonna get anything? Or is it 1% annual increase? Or if you do really well, you bring in like a prize, Nobel Prize, what are they gonna do, right? Are they gonna substantially increase your salary? You need to know those things. And what is your expected teaching load? That's a mistake not a lot of people do, not many people care about. But you need to ask, what am I gonna teach in the first year, second year, third year, and moving forward? If I bring in a lot of funding, how is that gonna vary? And so there are a lot of things you need, so some of these things are listed here. And most of the courses are moving online now, depending on which school you are. You need to ask the policy. If I teach 2 online courses, what does that mean? So there is a difference there. And if you are in a research lab, you need a lab space or something, ask how much space they're gonna give you and get it in writing. When you go there to visit, if they tell your lab is in renovation, don't trust them. Ask them to show which lab is gonna be mine. I want to see now. So there are things you need to be really careful when you go for interviews. What if you have multiple offers? These days, forget it. You are not going to have that luxury of unless you are like a field medalist or something to start with. But there may be one or two cases where you have two offers and you want to decide which one is good for you. There are many many criteria which go into that. Your spouse, you know, the weather, you know, Cleveland versus Florida, things like that. But make sure that everyone is on the same page. Don't act over smart. When you tell people, I have another offer, these are the numbers, this is the deadline, they will try to match that. So be honest, tell what's going on. That's gonna help you, that's gonna help everyone involved. And don't miss deadlines. If they tell you, we want to hear by April 1st, stay by that. And before you decline other offers, make sure you at least have one bird in hand, one accepted, done deal. You signed it, HR said, welcome to the club, have that in writing. Only then decline the other offers. Otherwise, keep them engaged. So once you have it in writing, once you finish, then you are not gonna have that much luxury after that. So enjoy what is left. Once you start your position, the party is over. So you're gonna get glasses like me. I went from 0.25, 0.25 to 1.25, 1.5 in 4 years. So you are gonna do a lot of reading. You are gonna be cringy. You're gonna be nagging. You have all the qualities of a faculty then. So enjoy your life. Take a break. Go somewhere, you know, drink best wine. Enjoy your life. Because once it starts, it's gonna really hit you hard. So if you didn't get any offer this year, just accept it. You know, the market is very competitive. There are 200 people for each position, maybe more. That's the way it is. Accept it. Identify your weaknesses. See what you need to improve and then start improving on that. Work on that. Just take it in a positive stride. Don't demand answers. Don't send an email to search committee telling how great you are and you know how, you know, don't push it. Don't rub it in. Just leave it there. And send an email to the department chair and ask when they're anticipating next position. That's very important. That tells how interested you are, and that tells that you are a person who really wants that job. So next time they have a position, they're gonna be keeping you in mind. And so just bottom line is gain their sympathy. Don't burn the bridges, that's very important. It's a very small world, you'll be surprised, you know. So. And you are going to stay in that field for really long, long time. So this is my timeline when I applied. I just want to give you an idea when I applied and when I got my email, you know, when it went. And so it's a long process. You can see that I submitted in September and I got offer in April, which is very normal, very typical. Sometimes it could be delayed further. Can anyone guess what happened in those two green rows there? I just left two rows blank here. Can anyone tell why? What's in there? So there can be what? No. So there can be things happening without your knowledge. The position went into hiring freeze a couple of times before they even interviewed and before they made the offer. And which is typical in Cleveland, everything freezes during that time. But so including this position. So I was not too surprised, but so the department has to go to provost and fight for the position to be opened so that they can recruit me. So I really am indebted to them that they have to put their credibility at risk. So, but a lot of things happen behind your background, so don't push the search committee. They cannot answer you sometimes, you know. So this is the last slide I have, and the third one really applies to everyone. Don't talk bad about anyone. You never know when that's gonna come and haunt you. So if you don't like someone, so be it. That's your opinion. But don't badmouth. Go to conference, drink wine, and then talk nonsense about your advisor. Don't do that. Because who you are talking may be a really good friend to your advisor. You may not know. So be really careful what you talk. It's a very political thing now. You know, you may choose to deny, but that's what it is. So, and anyways, the bottom line is talk to people. Get to know what you are good at, what you are not good at, and make sure you are improving on what you are not good at. Make sure your graduate school is not to take courses and get a 4.0 GPA. no one cares. Actually, your GPA is irrelevant when you apply for an academic position. No one cares. You can be 3.4, you can be 4.4, no one cares. But your skill set and how portable it is when you move is what is important. And that's all I have, so.
Thank you very much, Dr. Kripali. I think when we plan a series like this, we haven't done it before, so we just hope, you know, when we think and we plan, and we'd like to see that everyone's able to walk away with a little bit of something. Well, today with each of our panelists, I think that they've been able to share a plethora of useful advice on things that you can be doing now and what you can expect in your future, certainly. We are right about at our time limit, but I would like to open the floor just for a couple of moments if everyone's in agreement, if there are any pressing questions. Please, go ahead.
I do have a question. A lot of times when I go looking for academic jobs, it'll say that this was the deadline, but it's, you know, a year ago. And this was the deadline for this position. Is it possible that that's still open and they haven't updated that, or do they take those down?
You can send an email.
Okay.
Pick your phone and call the department secretary.
Okay.
They'll be able to tell you. So, most of the time, they don't invest time to remove things. Mm-hmm. They invest time to update things. You know, they post a new ad. But best thing is just send an email, a call. It just takes 2 minutes and it clarifies.
I was just wondering, there were a lot of material in your presentation that wasn't in the handout. I was wondering if we could contact Patty for a full PowerPoint, and with yours also, if that's all right?
Sure, yeah. So all the material in my handout, I think, will be available. I mean, the entire handout will be uploaded, and the handout has various hyperlinks that you can go and use.
Great. Thank you. That's a perfect segue for us.
Right on.
Right. What I pulled up here is a copy of, or it's the start of our website. We're doing a post-event website for this series because we know that it's, you know, it's very specific to your needs, and it's something that's, as you can tell by the skill of our panelists, it's not something that we can reproduce regularly. So we're posting the resources to the website. This list will be growing in the coming days, but here's some information from our previous two websites. For instance, you know, you can click on any one of these. This is the next one. Let's go back there again. The next one about the event coming up. So you'll be able to find the PowerPoints. Most of the panelists have given me their PowerPoint presentations and the handouts here. So just go to the Graduate Student Resource Center site in the College of Graduate Studies and you can find that there. We have small cards out in the hallway if you want to grab that with our website on it. So it should be a living document that will continue to be supplemented as time goes on. Yes.
My question is, if you kind of know the answer to the question of where you see yourself, like four-year tenure or long-term position, would you advise if there's an open position that you know is like filling a sabbatical or a short-term lecturer or is not a tenure-track position that is open, is it bad to take that position in terms of your goal to then be hired, because then they would have more inside knowledge versus just a CV and the other things that would come across their table, or do you think that it's an okay idea to take that as an entryway position into the university? If that's your actual dream, like college or position.
Well, I can tell you the advice that I received from my mentors. Don't make the assumption just because they know you that they will give you that position when it becomes a tenure track. They will go with the applicant that best meets the needs of that position. So if there's something else that you can do to make yourself an even stronger applicant, if and when the tenure track position comes down the road, go with the other route. Because unfortunately, the climate is such that lecturers and visiting professors just...
So maybe taking a Fulbright or a postdoc at like a Harvard or
absolutely.
Harvard would be better than...
Hands down, yes. At least that's my opinion.
It depends. If you have no teaching experience or you want to supplement your teaching experience, taking a visiting position, taking a sabbatical replacement, which are virtually the same, is certainly a way to get that. It's a way to get classroom teaching experience. If you're going to take that at a smaller college, and that's the environment you're thinking about going into, it'll give you experience. In that environment, do I want to be in that environment? You know, in our cases, when we have visiting positions for, you know, up to 3 years, and so in our case, our current visitor is done with their position now, there's no tenure track position that's following. Even if there was, it's always a national search. So it may help you if you've done a really good job. You may not automatically get an interview, but you might get an interview for the position. But there's no guarantee that the position continues on or that you're the number one candidate or anything. So you really have to look at it in terms of your career development. Would be the way to look at it.
And we can take maybe one more question. Go ahead, please.
I asked a question at the last one too, so if anyone else has a question, I don't want to. Okay. So, as Dr. Phillips had indicated, I'm in counseling science and we follow the science practitioner model. So I am not sure if I want to do the faculty route. So what feedback can you give on students like me who's kind of on the fence? Well, should I go into practice because I really like that, or should I teach, which I'm now becoming, you know, immersed in, which I really like too? You know what I mean? Because as you guys mentioned, now is the time for me to really demonstrate that I can teach or practice, and I'm not quite sure, like, you know what I mean, what to do with that, the dissonance.
I think my best advice is that you really have to kind of sit with that dissonance and dabble your feet in the different pools of practice, research, teaching, and find out kind of where you want to be. And the realities in psychology, given that we do teach, we do practice, and we also do research, is that there may be people who enjoy all three of those things, and it's harder for them to have a clear path then, and that's part of a challenge. There are hybrid positions out there that are more rare, and so they're more difficult probably to get, but they exist, and I know we have talked privately about some of those. So it's talking to people about, are there those types of opportunities out there if others are in a similar boat in different fields?
Coming also from a scientist practitioner model, I suppose, of clinical psychology, I would say don't close doors. So if you're graduating with a PhD, okay, then you will be license eligible and you'll be able to practice. And practice will always be available for you once you're licensed. However, teaching may or may not be depending upon the experiences that you pursued. So even if you're not sure, I would probably make a choice that leaves the most doors open down the road should you decide to go through one door or the other later.
Okay, thank you. We'll wrap it up now. I just want to say thank you again to everyone who attended this evening. Please find us online. I'll upload most of these materials by the end of the day tomorrow. Please watch for that. If you're interested in joining us next Monday evening, we'll be in the Student Center, room 313, for our final session, which will be about writing your CV. So hopefully we'll see you there. Thank you again for your time.
Thank you for all your time.